Welcome to the Hilton M. Briggs Library. This instruction is designed to teach you about one of the laws that affects you as a student. That law is Title 17 of the U.S. Code, copyright. By the end of this series of videos, you will know what copyright is, what is copyrightable, what rights are associated with copyright, to whom the rights are granted, what fair use is, what the public domain is, what plagiarism is and how it applies to you, how to use music and video sharing sites appropriately, how to use images legally, and how to use materials you find on the web appropriately. Let's begin by defining copyright. As indicated before, copyright is detailed in Title 17 of the U.S. Code. This is a very long and complicated law, but for our purposes, we will simplify it to the basics. This protection is available for both published and unpublished works. Section 102 of Title 17 lists the types of work that can be copyrighted. Literary works, musical works, including any accompanying words, dramatic works, including any accompanying music, pantomimes and choreographic works, pictorial, graphic, and sculptural works, motion picture and other audiovisual works, sound recordings, and architectural works. Section 106 lists the protections or rights that are granted by the copyright law. 1. To reproduce the copyrighted work in copies or phono records. 2. To prepare derivative works based on the copyrighted work. 3. To distribute copies or phono records of the copyrighted work to the public by sale or other transfer of ownership, or by rental, lease, or lending. 4. In the case of literary, musical, dramatic, or choreographic works, pantomimes, and motion pictures and other audiovisual works, to perform the copyrighted work publicly. 5. In the case of literary, musical, dramatic, and choreographic works, pantomimes, and pictorial, graphic, or sculptural works, including the individual images of a motion picture or other audiovisual work, to display the copyrighted work publicly. And 6. In the case of sound recordings, to perform the copyrighted work publicly by means of a digital audio transmission. These rights come into play for the preceding types of works when the work is fixed in any tangible medium. That means that you write something down or record something, it is possibly copyrighted. The writers of the law were foresighted enough to realize that methods of writing and creating art would be changing in the future, so they specified that the fixed medium could be anything in existence in 1976, when the law was originally passed, or developed in the future. To be copyrightable, something must have some originality as well. There is a non-exclusive list of works that are not copyrightable, listed in Section 102. Including an idea, a procedure or a process, a system, a method of operation, a concept, a principle, or a discovery. Next, let's look at who these rights are granted to. This seems like it would be a simple thing. The author, or creator, of course. But in reality, it isn't quite so easy. In many cases, this is true. What about a professor whose job it is to create a curriculum for her class? She was hired and is paid in part to write that curriculum, and she does a fantastic job of it. Does she own that curriculum? In fact, probably not. Because she was hired to write it, her employer probably owns the rights to it. The concept is that a piece of intellectual work is equivalent to the physical object that she might have made if she worked in a manufacturing facility rather than an institution of education. These intellectual objects are called works for hire and are defined in Section 101. So now we have creators sometimes owning the copyright and employers sometimes owning the copyright. That's not so hard to understand. The copyright owner can, however, sign the rights away, anything from just one right to the complete set. This often occurs when an author gets an article published in a newspaper, a magazine, or a journal. In that case, the newspaper, magazine, or journal will often take over ownership of the copyright. Even some book publishers require an author to sign over copyright in order to get a book published. Now, how do you know who owns the copyright of the item you want to use? It could actually be the author creator, the employer, or the publisher. But what if the creator has died since he or she created the work? Now you have the creator's heirs in the mix. Finding ownership of a specific copyright can become a nightmare. For this instruction, you just need to be aware that ownership is a complicated issue, but that basically, whoever creates something copyrightable will own that copyright. That is fine, but what is all this supposed to do? According to the U.S. Constitution, Congress is given the right to create copyright laws that should be used to promote the progress of science and useful arts by securing, for limited times to authors and inventors, the exclusive right to their respective writings and discoveries. That's from Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 8. This means that these rights must be balanced with the public's right to use copyrighted material to create new material. Note that in today's society, the purpose of copyright is often forgotten, and it is used as a vehicle to make money. While that is part of the purpose, after all, more people will spend their lives writing novels or music or creating art if they don't have to go to a day job to pay the rent as well. It is not the primary purpose of copyright. No living wage is guaranteed by copyright. There are provisions that make certain activities much easier and cheaper. The Fair Use Doctrine is one of those provisions and is presented in Section 107. This is a bit tricky because the guidelines for fair use are rather vague in the law and really only come into play in the courts. Of course, most of us would rather avoid the whole legal system when it comes to using information. So here are some guidelines to using the Fair Use Doctrine. The Fair Use Doctrine allows use of copyrighted materials for specific purposes. These include criticism, comment, news reporting, teaching, scholarship, and research. While other uses may be considered fair as well, these are specifically mentioned in the law. In order to qualify for fair use, the use must also pass a four-factor test. The purpose and character of the use, including whether such use is of a commercial nature or is for nonprofit educational purposes, the nature of the copyrighted work, the amount and substantiality of the portion used in relation to the copyrighted work as a whole, and the effect of the use upon the potential market for or value of the copyrighted work. Let's look a bit more closely at each factor. The first factor looks at the use. If you are using something for your schoolwork, that is good for this factor. But there are other uses that are favored as well. Here is a guideline that will help you determine whether your use favors fair use or not. The link for this full guideline will be given at the end of the session. If your use is for instruction, or in a student's case, being instructed, this factor is likely to weigh in your favor. If you transform a work, that also plays into your favor. By transforming a work, the courts tend to be looking not for a derivative work, but for a way of making the work something it wasn't before. For instance, when Google began indexing images on the web, it made thumbnail copies of the images to display on a results screen. This was considered highly transformative by the courts because the purpose of each image was completely changed in the use. On the other hand, using something that someone else created and publishing it, especially if you do it without attributing the work to the original creators, would definitely not favor fair use. The second factor looks at the work itself. This factor favors factual work rather than imaginative work. Scholarly articles with facts and figures are easier to claim fair use on than a novel, poem, or song. This factor also favors published over unpublished works. The third factor looks at how much and what part of a work you use. The how much should be a small amount and only the amount that is needed to meet the objective it is being used for. For example, if you are writing a paper and want to quote from one of your sources to illustrate a point, you should use only the bit that does illustrate your point and leave out anything that you might have used as filler. The other aspect of this factor is that you cannot use the heart of the work. Some of you may remember from history class that there was a president of the U.S. named Gerald Ford, and that he pardoned his predecessor in the office, Richard Nixon, who had been convicted of a number of crimes committed while in office, and of course he was also impeached. Ford later wrote an autobiography that was largely an explanation of his pardon of Nixon. A magazine called The Nation published a small portion of that autobiography in an article about it. The courts found that, although the published material was a small amount of the whole work, it was the heart of the work, and therefore not fair use. The final factor is the effect on a potential market or the value of a work. Note that this looks at potential markets, not an existing one. In some cases, simply by using a work, a market is created for it. For students, the key is that you make one or only a few copies. Other considerations factoring fair use would be that there is no licensing mechanism available for the item. This means that you are not able to negotiate with some company or other to make the material available, usually for cost. Examples of licensing mechanisms available to you as students at SDSU would include all those articles you got when you searched the EBSCOhost Megafile or the ProQuest databases. Briggs Library licenses all those articles for you. This factor favors fair use only when such a mechanism is not available at all, not just when we don't have a license to it. Fair use would be favored if your use actually stimulated a market for the original work as well. Things that would go against fair use in this factor would include repeated use of the same material. Faculty run up against this all the time when they want to copy and hand out the same article for a class semester after semester. Somewhat obviously, impairing the market for a work would also be non-favorable. Fair use is not all we have to rely on. Copyright, by constitutional mandate, is only permitted for a limited time. The Supreme Court has indicated that a limited time really means any time frame with an ending date, not a short time. At this point, copyright extends to the life of the author plus 70 years. If a work is a work for hire, copyright extends for 95 years from publication, or 120 years from the date of creation. As with all copyright issues, the length of copyright is actually much more complicated than I have listed here, but this is a good beginning. So what happens 70 years after the author dies? The works go into the public domain. This means that anyone can use the works as they please, although they must still attribute the work to the original creator. Have you noticed how many movies have been created on the basis of Jane Austen novels in the last few years? Wonder why that is? It is, of course, because her novels were wonderful, but also because they have come into the public domain, and the studios no longer have to pay whoever inherited the copyrights humongous fees to make a movie from her novels. So, do you want to recite an entire sonnet from Shakespeare at the next open mic night? Go ahead. Want to play a Debussy prelude on a concert and record it? No problem. How about quoting extensive amounts of Charles Darwin's Origin of the Species in your next paper? Copyright says sure, but make sure it is an appropriate use for the assignment or your grade might suffer. Types of works in the public domain include federal government documents, works that were published before 1923, works whose authors have been dead for at least 70 years. And actually, there are some people who feel that what they create should be used by others, and they put their work into the public domain or make free licenses for certain types of uses right away. We'll look a bit more at this practice when we look at images, but it will apply to other types of materials as well. It is important in all of your work, in college and out of it, to attribute where you got your information. In that spirit, here is the bibliography for this video.